Thank you, sir, for your kind and detailed introduction. Thank you, Dr. Vaidyanath Solanki, sir. I hope my slides are visible. Are my slides visible? Yes. Slides are visible, hopefully. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah, cool. Thank you. All right. So at the outset, I would like to first thank Dr. Banshee Sahu, sir, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. And it's indeed a pleasure to be a part of Dark Hair Con. So the purpose and preamble of my talk is to actually decode the exact role and significance of using biosimilar insulin, particularly in the Indian context. So to set the context, in fact, is almost an extension of what Dr. M.C. Deepak sir was saying. The new policy that was implemented in the United States, which is the Biological Price Competition and Innovation Act, this kind of paved the way for the approval of the first of its kind interchangeable biosimilar insulin by the US FDA. This has in fact been considered as a landmark moment because the validation by the US FDA has kind of opened the doors for its widespread use across the country. This is likely to have a profound impact, not just in terms of the healthcare point of view, but also in reducing the expenditure, even in a developed economy such as the US. So it's only fair to point out that in India, obviously adopting the biosimilar insulin is going to have a huge impact, huge favorable influence in Indian context itself. So with that, what exactly are biosimilars? Biosimilars are nothing but biological copies of the innovator. These are far different from generics. Generics are usually pills of small composition, chemical compositions, which are very stable compounds and can be easily replicated into identical copies. But biosimilar, on the other hand, they are larger molecules, more intricate molecules, and are proteins which are usually made in living species with the process of biotechnology using very, very special ingredients. It's a far more complex process. And these are never identical, and they are always similar to the innovator product. And that's why the nomenclature biosimilar. Some of the other examples of biosimilars other than insulin, of course, are GLP-1 receptor agonists, growth hormones, monoclonal antibodies, so on and so forth. So requiring a complex process to develop a biosimilar product, it also requires very detailed regulatory development, almost as an originator, but it is not as time consuming because they need to go through in vitro, in vivo studies, as well as PK/PD studies to demonstrate safety, purity, potency, and also similarity to the reference product. So why do we need biosimilars? What are the advantages of biosimilars? If you look at an innovative product, usually from the conceptualizing stage to actually when they see the light of the day, it perhaps may take anywhere between 7 to 10 years. And it might also incur anywhere about $100 to $300 million. So it's almost comparable to a space mission project. That's how complex it is to kind of develop an innovative product. And it is also fair to say it is not possible to reach the increasing demand of insulin and also to make it affordable to reach all quarters of the world. And that's exactly the gap where biosimilar products kind of come and fill in. So they kind of complement the original product and help to penetrate and reach larger number of diabetic patients across the globe. So that's the advantage of biosimilar insulin. So what are the clinicians' perspectives choosing a biosimilar insulin? Some of the fundamental parameters that we obviously look at is the efficacy and the safety. And then we also look at the price point at which the drug operates, because we are all kind of sensitized to the fact that the patients with diabetes may require insulin for a longer duration, considering obviously the chronic nature of the disease itself. So can we switch over from an innovative product to a biosimilar product? Is it that easy to switch over, or do we have to contemplate and worry about switching over? And as I already alluded to, There've been no flouting of norms, and we've seen that these are drugs which go through rigorous trials. And if a molecule has additional interchangeable data, then switching becomes far more convenient, far more easier. So moving from one innovative product to a biosimilar product becomes effortless when the product actually has the interchangeable data. Obviously, it comes along with the quality, safety, as well as being cost effective. So the need of affordable insulins, we know that we have a plethora of molecules with us, but we know that the prices have also been skyrocketing over the years. Approximately $20 to $22 billion are spent in purchasing insulin across the globe. And the numbers are only going to get higher, and it is always a challenge to meet the increasing demand of the insulin requirement. And on the other hand, there's also a demand versus supply gap. 33 million patients with type 2 diabetes do not have access to insulin, and the numbers are only going to get higher to about 41 million in the coming years. These are staggering number of people. And this is exactly where the biosimilar kind of act as pragmatic solutions, and they fill the gap, and they could really, really complement the innovator products. Obviously, we need to give the due merit to the innovator product. It becomes a huge, tedious process, you know, from the innovation to actually, as I said, to see the light of the day. But at the same time, we have to give the deserved credit and merit to even biosimilars. And obviously, with the use of biosimilars, not only in terms of the penetration, there could be a huge impact, both in terms of the public as well as the private healthcare expenditure. So coming back to the interchangeable nomenclature, this is the highest degree of approval to a biosimilar insulin. So it's a notch above the standard approval of a biosimilar insulin. Interchangeable is a higher notch. And this is where the product is switched over between both the innovator as well as the interchangeable product has been switched back and forth to test the efficacy and safety between each other. And as I mentioned, the FDA approved it in July this year. So what the approval means to the world is that the high-quality insulin, glargine, becomes far more affordable and accessible to the millions of diabetic patients living across the world. So some of the international perspectives on the interchangeability, the EMA and the European Commission suggest that the interchangeable product needs to achieve the same clinical effect, whereas the FDA and the US Congress go a step ahead and actually suggest that the biological product may be even substituted for the reference, even without the intervention of the healthcare provider. So let's look at some clinical evidence. The Biocon's glargine has been approved by most major markets across the globe. Some of the important studies have been highlighted, and most of the study outcomes have been quite consistent across the globe. And let's look a little deeper, dive into Insight 3 and look at data between the both innovator reference product, which is Sanofi's glargine, as well as Biocon's glargine, to look at the safety as well as the immunogenicity. So Insight 3 comprises of 127 type 1 diabetic patients who were randomized into two groups, Arm B, comprised of the reference insulin glargine and Lispro, whereas Arm A was initiated with Biocon's insulin glargine for a duration of 12 weeks, after which they were switched over to the reference glargine for a period of 12 weeks and again switched back to Biocon's insulin glargine. And it was a robust design with adequate switch periods. And there was an observation at week 36 and another follow-up at week 40. So as we can see from this illustration, the HbA1c is pretty uniform between both the arms. The change in HbA1c is quite consistent between arms A and arm B. And again, as we can see from this illustration, the overall incidence of hyperglycemia between the two were quite comparable, and there was no severe hyperglycemia event occurred during any time during the study. So the immunogenicity data is also quite comparable. The antibody was similar between both the arms. The red line represents the non-switching sequence, the blue represents the switching sequence. So INSTRIDE 1 was a study with type 1 diabetic patients, INSTRIDE 2 with type 2 diabetic patients, both showing the proportion of patients with cross-reactive insulin antibody response. And as you can clearly see from this illustration, they are both comparable, both in INSTRIDE 1 as well as INSTRIDE 2 between Biocon's glargine as well as the innovator glargine. The immunogenicity assessment in INSTRIDE 1 and INSTRIDE 2, majority of type 2 diabetic patients, as expected, were negative for the total antibody response. And in type 1 diabetic patients, they were positive for antibodies for insulin as expected, as consistent with previous studies. So the United Kingdom recommends that people who prefer to use biosimilar insulin should be encouraged. So as pretty much to the thoughts that we have in India. So to finally conclude, as I mentioned, Biocon's insulin glargine has been recognized with the highest level of approval, which is the interchangeability data. And as we know over the years, it has a robust evidence, and we have some very, very rich clinical experience using this insulin. And as I've been mentioning, I think the embracing of the use of this insulin could have a profound impact on both private as well as healthcare expenditure, particularly in our country. Thank you very much.